Good evening, dear viewers of Akshay.com by Vetri from Pondicherry. Last class, I have discussed what is a solution, what are the different types of solutions, what are the concentration terms we are using in the laboratory also I have discussed. What is the colligative property I have discussed, what are the different types of colligative properties also I have discussed. Today, let me continue the second most important colligative property, that is elevation of boiling point. Elevation of boiling point is another important colligative property. Let me discuss. So before entering into elevation of boiling point, first let me discuss what is boiling point. So you must know the definition for boiling point. Boiling point of a liquid is a temperature at which its vapor pressure becomes equal to atmospheric pressure. Let me repeat again. Boiling point of liquid is a temperature at which its vapor pressure becomes equal to atmospheric pressure. So, vapor pressure I have already discussed. The most important information is liquids having a relatively lower vapor pressure will have higher boiling points and vice versa. This is the most important information you must know. Liquids having a relatively lower vapor pressure will have higher boiling points. Whereas liquids have relatively higher vapor pressure will have lower boiling points. This is the very important information. To give you evidence, I have given an example here. So at 20 degrees centigrade, water has the vapor pressure of 2.3 kPa, whereas alcohol is 5.95 kPa, kilopascal. The idea here it is, water is having low vapor pressure when compared to alcohol. So, lower vapor, when compared to alcohol, water is having lower vapor pressure. Then, the water will be having higher boiling point. We know 100 degree centigrade is the boiling point of water. Whereas alcohol is low, it is 78 point. So this is the interesting information you must know. That means the lower the vapor pressure, higher will be the boiling point is the conclusion. Okay, let me go for the next one. When a non-volatile solute is dissolved in a volatile solvent, the boiling point of the solvent will be raised. This is another interesting information you must know. So we are noting the boiling point of any solvent. Suppose when we are dissolving a non-volatile solute, the boiling point of the solution will be higher, raised. So this phenomenon is known as elevation of boiling point, because the boiling point is increased when compared to solvent to solution. So this phenomenon is known as elevation of boiling point. And it is a direct consequence of the lowering of vapor pressure. Just now I have discussed. Lower the vapor pressure, higher the boiling point. Higher the vapor pressure, lower the boiling point. So it is a direct consequence of the lowering of vapor pressure. This fact can be understood as follows. Let me explain as follows. So kindly see here. So I am going to explain the elevation of boiling point with this specific diagram. So here, vapor pressure is plotted versus temperature for both solvent and solution. So the idea here it is, AB is a curve for solvent curve. And vapor pressure is plotted for temperature for a pure solvent, let it be AB is a curve. So this AB curve cuts at 1 atmosphere pressure, that is at P0. So P0 is the vapor pressure of pure solvent. The corresponding temperature is T0. Similarly, CD is the vapor pressure curve for solution after dissolving a non-volatile solute in the solvent. So CD is the vapor pressure curve for solution. So which occurs at 1 atmospheric pressure at P. So P is the vapor pressure of solution. This is the interesting. The corresponding temperature is T. So, T T naught is the boiling point of the pure solvent and T is the boiling point of solution. So T here you can see T is always greater than T naught. That's why we are calling it as elevation of boiling point. This is the most important information. So boiling point of solution will be always greater than boiling point of the solvent. Another interesting information is both the solvent as well as the solution always, the vapor pressure of solvent as well as the vapor pressure of solution always increases with increase of temperature. You can see from the curve AB and CD. Both solvent and solution vapor pressure increases with increase of solution. This is another. The most another important thing, any particular temperature, say for example here at T naught, the vapor pressure, here it is, vapor pressure, that is P naught, vapor pressure at particular temperature, is always the correspondingly lower than the vapor pressure of pure solvent. This is the another interesting information you can get from this. Okay, now let me go to the next one. So just now I am giving you the same information. The vapor pressure of the pure solvent and the solution increases with increase in temperature. Just now I have explained both the AB and CD, both curves increase with increase in temperature. The vapor pressure of the solution will be lower than that of pure solvent at any given temperature. That also I have explained. If you take any particular temperature and if you measure the vapor pressure of solution as well as vapor pressure of the pure solvent at particular same temperature, it is very clear the vapor pressure of solution will be always lower than that of pure solvent at any given temperature. Okay. Thus, let us say now, if T is the boiling point of solution and T naught is the boiling point of solvent, then elevation of boiling point is defined as the difference between the boiling points of the solution and the pure solvent. That is delta TB equal to T minus T naught. This is the interesting information. So this is the elevation of boiling point. Let me repeat again. Elevation of boiling point is defined as the difference between the boiling points of a solution and the pure solvent. Mathematically, delta TB equal to T minus T naught. So this is the interesting information. Okay, now according to Raoult's law, we have already discussed even under the vapor pressure, lowering of vapor pressure, I have discussed. So according to Raoult's law, elevation of boiling point is directly proportional to molality of the solution. This is the most important competitive question can be asked. So elevation of boiling point is directly proportional to the molality of the solution. So mathematically, I can give like this. Delta TB, elevation of boiling point, T minus T naught, proportional to M molality. What is molality? We have already discussed the term molality. Number of moles of solute dissolved in 1 kilogram of solvent. That is molality. Okay, this is directly proportional to M. Okay, let me go for the next one. So from this, we can determine the molecular weight of any unknown solute. That is, our aim is always, in all the cases of colligative properties, our aim is to determine the molecular weight of any given unknown solute. That is our aim. So same way, here also, we can determine the molecular weight from the elevation of boiling point as follows. We know, just now I have discussed, the elevation of boiling point is directly proportional to molality of solution. Mathematical form, this is the mathematical form. Okay, now what's the next step? So in order to equate, I am putting now another KB, a constant that is called the proportionality constant. KB is the proportionality constant. So I am getting a very, very important equation. Delta TB equal to KB into M. What is delta TB? We know elevation of boiling point, T minus T naught. What is M? We know molality of the any given solution. We know the from the definition. We know what is now KB. KB is nothing but is a proportionally constant, but they can give a specific name, molar boiling point elevation constant. How can you define this? Let me define now. Here, KB is the characteristic of any solvent and is called molar boiling point elevation constant. Can you follow? Molar boiling point elevation constant, or another name, ebullioscopy constant. So KB is called molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopy constant. So that is usually represented with KB. So KB for water, it is constant value. It is 0.52 for water. So you must remember, whether suppose in during competitive examination questions, sometimes they may give, sometimes may not give the value, but for water we have to memorize. So KB value for water is 0.52. This is the interesting information. Okay. Now we know KB value for water. So how to define molar boiling point elevation constant? Let me define now. The molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopy constant may be defined as the elevation of boiling point of one molar solution. Very, very simple. So this we are getting from the simple equation. What is the equation? We know just delta TB, that is equal to KB into M. This is the equation. So molar boiling point elevation constant, that is KB, or ebullioscopy, may be defined as elevation of boiling point, that is nothing but delta TB, when M equal to 1. That is one molar solution. If M equal to 1, KB equal to delta B. This is a very, very simple definition. Let me repeat again. The molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopy constant may be defined as the elevation of boiling point of one molar solution. Or in other form also I can define. What way? That is, the molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopy constant may be defined as the elevation of boiling point when 1 gram molecular weight of this solute, that is one mole, is dissolved in 1 kilogram of solvent. This is very another interesting definition, same way in other form. So let me repeat again. The molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopy constant may be defined as the elevation of boiling point when 1 gram molecular weight of solute, that is 1 mole, dissolved in 1 kilogram of solvent. Okay, now, so we know, we have already arrived, delta TB equal to KB into M. We know already delta TB, elevation of boiling point. KB, molar boiling point elevation constant, M, molality. Okay, but we know from the definition, I have already pointed out, what is the definition? Number of moles of solute in 1 kilogram of water. So M equal to N2 by W1. N2, number of moles of solute. W1, that is weight of solvent in kilogram. So on substituting this value, so we are getting a very, very interesting another equation. That is delta TB equal to KB into N2 divided by W1. Now, the interesting information is, so we are now arriving, that is, elevation of boiling point is a colligative property, competitively, normally, question will be asked. How will you prove, even in Kayin or CBSE or Samichir, board examination, they can ask you, prove, elevation of boiling point is a colligative property. So, what do you have to do now? Up to that, you have to bring, and just to stop at this stage, that is, delta TB equal to KB into N2 by W1. So, elevation of boiling point is a colligative property because delta TB depends on N2, number of moles of solute. Since it depends on number of moles of solute, it is a colligative property. Very, very interesting information. Okay, now. So, now, then I will substitute. What is N2? You know, N2 is number of moles of solute. So, by substituting N2 value as M2, small m2 by capital M2, small m2 mass of solute, capital M2 molecular mass of solute. So I can get an equation delta TB equal to KB into small m2 divided by capital M2 into W1. What are the terms? Let me repeat again. Delta TB, elevation of boiling point. KB molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopy constant. Small m to mass of solute we are using in the laboratory. The capital M to molecular weight of the given solute. W1, it is nothing but the mass of solvent we are using in kilogram. So these are the terms it is involved. Okay, using this equation, I can rearrange and will get for molecular weight. So the same equation, I will rearrange. So M2 is equal to, so KB into M2 divided by delta GB and W1. This is the our required equation. That means molecular weight of any given unknown solid, if you want to calculate, so what are the terms we must know? We must know now KB, molar boiling point elevation constant. This is a constant for any particular solvent. It is available in the literature. M2, we are going to use in the laboratory, so we know the value. W1, nothing but the amount of solvent, that is in weight of solvent in kilogram, we are going to use, so we know the value. So that is delta TB, nothing but elevation of boiling point, we are measuring in the laboratory. So, by knowing the right side, all the terms, M2 can be calculated. Molecular weight of any unknown given solids can be calculated. This is the interesting information. So, this is the way we have to determine the molecular weight. The only remaining what we have to discuss is how to measure delta TB. This is the interesting information. Delta TB, how to measure. So, this is a special method we are applying by F.G. Cottrell. What you are seeing is apparatus used by F.G. Cottrell. The interesting information is, it's a graduated tube, boiling tube. It's a graduated boiling tube having one hole in rubber cork through which a thermometer T is introduced. And it's having a side tube. It is connected to a condenser. So water can be circulated. So when during boiling, any vapor is going out, it is gets condensed and coming to this. It is prevented by the sheath here, so the condensed liquid will not come and touch here, so it will go here. This is the interesting information. So this special apparatus is called Cottrell's apparatus. Okay, just see what is the procedure we have to follow. So in order to measure delta TB, so we have to take a known given one known mass of solvent, say W1 gram, and introduce through the side tube. And take this, and we have to boil this again inside an inverted funnel. This is, see here, an inverted funnel is there, and having this just here, it will be like this inverted funnel. And you imagine like this, so what will happen now? Through this, vapors along with this, that is liquid, will go and touch the boiling point, that is the bulb of the thermometer. So while we are boiling, the vapors as the liquid will go and contact the bulb of the thermometer. So normally ordinary boiling point, what we are doing is, thermometer will be putting inside this solvent. It is not the correct way, because it should show only the vapors should touch the thermometer, then only it will be accurate. Okay, let me explain this. So but just see, this is an apparatus, graduated tube. Inside, yeah, the inverted funnel is kept inside. It's having a side tube and also the another one having one hole upper cork through which the thermometer is introduced. So, let me explain the procedure. Kindly follow. While measuring the boiling point of a solution that I have discussed, the thermometer is usually placed in the liquid. This is a normal procedure. They are placed in the liquid, but it's not correct. So, not in the vapor. As a result, there is a possibility of serious error due to superheating. So, in order to avoid, a special apparatus used by the Cottrell. Hence, the thermometer T is placed above the surface of the boiling liquid in A. You have seen already in the Cottrell method. It is not inside the liquid, it is above the liquid. And bubbles formed at the thick platinum wire B force a stream of liquid and the vapor to flow through the funnel over the thermometer bulb. So the vapor as well as liquid will flow through the funnel over the thermometer bulb. So thermometer is now thus covered with this vapor. Only vapor is covering. So it is giving accurate value of the temperature. Right. So the temperature recorded thus represent the boiling point. This is the interesting information. I have already found a side tube C leads to a condenser. So any vapor which is escaping will get condensed by circulating water. The sheet they deep prevent the cold condensate from reaching the thermometer, so thermometer will not be getting cold. So this is the arrangement. Okay, now let me go for the precision. So in the precision work, the boiling points of solvent T0 and solution T should be determined simultaneously, should be determined immediately at the same temperature. Why? So as to avoid error due to possible changes in the atmospheric pressure. So when you are recording the boiling point of solvent as well as solution, so we have to do simultaneously. So we have to suppose if you take solvent in one particular day and solution another particular day, now it will not be accurate result because there may be possible change in the atmospheric pressure. So it is highly recommended that so should be determined both the boiling points of solvent and solution should be determined simultaneously so as to avoid the error due to possible changes in the atmospheric pressure. This is the most important information. So now let me explain the procedure. The apparatus just now seen used here consists of a graduated boiling tube, you have seen already, and an inverted funnel is placed inside the tube. Okay, that also I have shown you. Now, a known weight of solvent W1 gram is first placed in the boiling tube and the liquid is allowed to boil. After placing this, liquid is allowed to boil. When the liquid starts boiling, it pumps a stream of liquid and the vapor over the bulb of the thermometer. That is, the thermometer held little above the liquid, over the liquid, you have seen already in the diagram. Thus, the bulb is covered with a thin layer of boiling liquid, which is in equilibrium with the vapor. So, the boiling point is noted as T0. This is the interesting information. Okay, then after noting T0, then what you have to do now? Then, the vapors of a liquid is cooled with the help of water condenser, we have already have. Then after cooling, after vapor gets condensed, its temperature is coming down, then a known weight of solute is added in the boiling tube. Known weight of solute, that is W2, known weight of solute, W2, or we can say in this case we have used as M2 we have using. So M2, a known weight of solute, M2, small M2, is added automatically inside it in the boiling tube through the side tube, and the boiling point of solution is noted as before, now as T. Originally with the pure solvent we have noted the boiling point T0. Now after adding small m2 amount of solute, again we are noting the boiling point of solution as T. So from these two readings T0 and T, the molecular weight of an unknown solute can be determined. This is the interesting information. Okay. The difference between the two boiling points gives the elevation of boiling point, T minus T0. So knowing the mass of the solute M2, the mass of the solvent W1, and the ebullioscopic constant KB, the molecular weight of unknown solute can be calculated as follows using the equation. This is the interesting information. So knowing the mass of the solute M2, the mass of the solvent W1 and ebullioscopic constant KB, the molecular weight of unknown solute M2 can be calculated as follows using the following equation. That is, M2 is equal to capital M2 equal to KB into small M2 divided by delta TB and W1. So delta TB we are just measuring from the laboratory, and we can introduce this value. KB it is constant for every particular solvent. M2 we are weighing and adding, we know the value. W1 we are taking the known amount of solute solvent. So that also we can include. So M2 can be calculated. So this is the way we can determine the elevation of boiling point by FG Cotter method. This is a special method we can. So question can be asked. Elevation of boiling point can be determined by FG Cotter method, Ostwald and Walker method, Berkeley, and so many methods. By giving the method they will ask. So kindly follow. Elevation of boiling point is determined by FG Cotter method. Okay. Next. Now next let me go for the third colligative property depression of breathing. This is another interesting part, the qualitative property. Depression of breathing. So as you said, what is freezing point? Then I will come for the depression. So freezing point of a liquid is defined as the temperature at which vapor pressure of the liquid is equal to vapor pressure of the corresponding solid. Let me repeat again. Freezing point of a liquid is defined as the temperature at which the vapor pressure of the liquid is equal to the vapor pressure of the corresponding solid. This is called the freezing point. Then what is the depression of freezing point? Let me explain. Just before that, just look at this. Here, vapor pressure is plotted versus temperature for solvent as well as solution. And here, depression of freezing point is noted. Kindly follow. So what is here? The curve CB, it is the pure solvent. And BD, it is the frozen solvent. And DAD, it is the solid. Where a solution is, ED curve is the solution. The interesting information. So here, the idea here it is, T naught is the corresponding freezing point of the pure solvent, and the T is the freezing point of the solution. So always, the freezing point of solution will be lower than that of freezing point of pure solvent. This is called the difference of freezing point. This is the interesting information. So, freezing point of solution will be always lower than that of pure solvent. So, whenever a non-volatile solid is added to a pure solvent, freezing point will be always lower. So, this is called the depression of freezing point. Okay, let me explain now. So, when a non-volatile solid is dissolved in a volatile solvent, just now I have discussed, the freezing point of solvent is lower. Just now. The freezing point of a solution is therefore lower than that of pure solvent. Here, T0 is the freezing point of solvent and T is the freezing point of solution. Then, this phenomenon is known as depression of freezing point. Now, which may be defined as the difference in the freezing point of a solvent and the solution. This is the most important. The difference of freezing point is defined as the difference in freezing point of solvent T naught and the solution T. Okay, this is now. So now I can give mathematical form delta T of is equal to T naught minus T, because T naught will be always greater than T, or other way, T is always smaller than T naught. So delta Tf is equal to T naught minus T. This is the mathematical form. Okay, what is now? So delta Tf, nothing but it is the difference of freezing point. The correspondingly, that is we are getting from the T naught minus T. Okay. Now, according to Raoult's law, we have discussed already, the difference of freezing point delta Tf is directly proportional to molality of the solid. Directly proportional to molality of the solution. This is the interesting information. So, I can give mathematically, delta Tf is directly proportional to M. Delta Tf, that is the difference of freezing point, M, molality. Okay, now, do not equate. So, from this equation, I can determine the molecular weight. So, how to determine the molecular weight? The next step is determination of molecular weight from the depression of freezing point. So I will use the same equation, because I have carried over here delta T with directly proportional M. I can rewrite this equation by introducing a constant. Delta Tf is equal to Kf into M, where Kf is the proportionality constant. Kf is the proportionality constant. So now I can give you a special name for this. It is molar, the depression of freezing point constant. So let me define what is that. So here, Kf is the characteristic of solvent, as in the case of Kp, and is called molar freezing point depression constant or cryoscopic constant. Very, very interesting. Can you follow? The elevation of boiling point, we have given already Kp, we have called as ebullioscopic constant, whereas Kf we are calling cryoscopic constant. Question can be asked, kindly have it in mind. So Kf இது கால்ட் மோலார் ஃப்ரீசிங் பாயிண்ட் டிப்ரஷன் கான்ஸ்டன்ட் ஆர் கிரையோஸ்கோபிக் கான்ஸ்டன்ட். As usual, Kf for water is 1.86 for water. It is a constant. So 1.86 for water Kf value. Okay, now I am going to define. What is Kf? Let me say, the molar freezing point depression constant, the molar freezing point depression constant or cryoscopic constant may be defined as the depression of freezing point of one molar solution. Very, very interesting. As in the case, previous case, one molar solution. What is that? We know that if delta Pf is equal to, so Kf into M. What is Kf? Just now, what is Kf? Molar freezing point depression constant or cryoscopic constant. So this Kf is equal to delta Tf when M equal to 1. When M equal to 1, this is, that is the definition. The molar freezing point depression constant or cryoscopic constant may be defined as the depression of freezing point of one molar solution. In other way, I can define the molar freezing point depression constant or cryoscopic constant may be defined as the depression of freezing point when 1 gram molecular weight of the solute, 1 gram molecular weight of solute is dissolved in 1 kilogram of solvent. So this is the another way of giving the definition. Okay, let me go for next. So I know the equation is delta Tf is equal to Kf and Dm. This is I am getting from the Raoult's law. Okay, this is a mathematical form. I am getting into delta T will directly promote to M. So by introducing the constant, proportional to the constant Kf, I am getting this equation. Okay. So from this, now I am getting the molecular weight I am going to derive. What way? But I know from the definition of molality M equal to N2 by W1. So I will substitute for M value. So I am getting an equation. Delta Tf is equal to Kf into N2 divided by W1. What are the terms? Delta Tf, the depression of freezing point. Kf, that is we have discussed already, molar depression of freezing point constant. N2, number of moles of solute. W1, that is the weight of solvent in kilogram. Kindly follow N2, number of moles of solute. So delta Tf is directly proportional to N2, that is depends on N2. Thus, the depression of freezing point is a colligative property. Again, we are proving. So, depression of freezing point is a colligative property. So, whenever a question is asked, so just arrive at this state, then you can say, give the statement, how the depression of freezing point is a colligative property. So, by giving this equation, you can say, delta Tf is depends on the number of moles of solid N2. So, depression of freezing point is a colligative property. Okay. But I know the value for N2. N2 is equal to definition, number of moles of solute, small m2 by capital M2. Molecular, the mass of solute divided by molecular mass of solute. So substituting this, I am getting the equation that is delta Tf is equal to Kf into small m2 by capital M2 into W1. All the terms we know. That is delta Tf, the difference, difference of freezing point. Kf, that is we have seen already, molar freezing, difference of freezing point constant. M2, mass of the solute, small m2. Capital M2, molecular weight of solute. W1, mass of solvent in kilogram. So my rearranging, I can get, so my aim is I have to get molecular mass. So I can bring M2 here, delta Tf here. I can change this equation as, that is, M2 is equal to Kf divided by delta Tf into small m2 divided by W1. So this is the interested equation we have. So this is by using this equation, I can determine the molecular weight of any given unknown solute. The only thing is, what are the data available? Kf, that is any solvent is known from the literature. M2, I am going to weigh, I am going to use, I know. W1, I am going taking the solvent, I know. So delta Tb, I am measuring, delta Tf, I am measuring in the laboratory. By substituting all the values, I can calculate M2. So the only remaining I have to discuss is how to determine the delta Tf, difference of freezing point. So now I am going to discuss this method using Beckmann thermometer, that is Beckmann method. So measurement of depression of freezing point. measurement of deformation of breaking point using Bethmann method. Let me discuss now. So by measuring this value, by introducing this value into the equation, M2 can be calculated. So what are the apparatus required here? Bethmann thermometer is most important. Number one, freezing tube, that is the outer freezing tube is necessary, that is the inner tube, guard tube, outer tube, stirrer and void vessel for freezing mixture. So these are the vessels it is required. Just see here. So this is what we have seen, Bethmann thermometer. It is a special apparatus, will give only the difference. It will not give accurate freezing point. Kindly follow. It is only difference only it can be measured. It's a differential thermometer. This is interesting information. So if you look into this graduation starting from here, it is 0, 1, that is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 6 value. The same rate that from top 0 and below 6. So only this 6, the divisions are 0 to 6 degree. But the interesting information, it is further subdivided in such a way that we can measure up to 0.01 Kelvin can be measured. This is the interesting information. Using this special thermometer, Bethmann, we can measure the value of 0.01 Kelvin can be measured. This is a very, very advantage, interesting advantage of using Bethmann thermometer. So what we are now seeing is the Bethmann apparatus. What are the way? The outer vessel containing, this is the corresponding freezing mixture containing. Then there is another, is the vessel is outer tube is there here. And inside the inner tube is there. Inner tube having one whole rubber cloth through which the thermometer is present. And is having a side tube through which we can add solvent as well as solute. So what this is the apparatus. So what we are going to do now? So normally what we will do? Normally we will take a known amount of solvent. And we will introduce in the inner tube. Along the side tube. Then insert the Bethmann thermometer. Then introduce in the outer tube, then the entire apparatus we can keep it in the freezing mixture. We have to stir it and allow to cool. So when the solvent is getting cool, the temperature drops slowly. So after reaching a particular temperature, there will be again sudden shoot up will be there. Because when it is solidified, the temperature will come up and will stand still, will be constant. That temperature we have to note, that is the freezing point of the pure solvent. Okay. So after that, what we have to do now? Remove the inner tube from the outer because it's already solidified. It's already solidified. Then just boil it in a water bath and make it in a clear solution. Cool it. Then a known quantity of solute, that is M2, introduced into through the side tube. Again, introduce the Bethmann thermometer along with that. Introduce again in the outer tube. Then entire apparatus setup you can insert into the freezing mixture. Again, you note the freezing point of solution now. So again, as usual, on cooling, stirring, the freezing mixture is going on, the temperature is going on, going down. Again, and after reaching the mercury thermometer is going down slowly. After reaching a particular minimum, suddenly it shoot up and still stand constant. That is the freezing point of the solution. So from this difference, that is T and T naught, we can able to differentiate delta Tf. So let me see the idea here. What I have seen, just a known rate of solvent W is placed in the inner tube, I have already explained, and cooled slowly with the stirring. The movement of mercury in the Bethmann thermometer is noted. This is already informed. The temperature drops steadily and reaches a level below that of freezing point of the solvent. So, this is the interesting information. So, as the crystallization of solvent begins, the temperature shoots up and remain steady. This steady temperature is recorded as the freezing point of pure solvent. This is the interesting information. The next one. After that, the tube is taken out of the freezing mixer and the solvent is remelted. I have already found it. Remelted using hot water bath. Then, cool it. A known weight of the solute M2 is added to the solvent through the side arm C. It is again allowed to dissolve. Introduced in the entire setup in the freezing mixer. The freezing point of the resulting solution is determined the same way as T. The first one only solvent T naught, only with solute again T. So we are getting the two readings from this. So the difference between the two freezing points gives the differential freezing point, that is T naught minus T. knowing the mass of the soul is m2, mass of the solvent w1, cryoscopic constant kf, which is the characteristic of any solvent, the molecular weight of solid capital m2 can be calculated as follows using the following equation. So this is the equation we are going to apply. So I have already kf is a constant for any particular solid matter. I have already explained 1.86. M2, I am taking a known amount of solute. Capital M1, I have taken a known quantity of solvent. And delta Tf, I have measured already T0 and Tf. So T0 and T. So by substituting all the values, I can determine the M2 molecular weight of any given unknown solute using the Beckmann method. So this is the way we can determine the molecular weight after measuring the depression of freezing point by Beckmann method. This is the interesting information. So, let me go over the osmotic pressure. So, in order to go, before entering into osmotic pressure, let us understand first, what is osmosis? Osmotic pressure is usually indicated by pi. What is osmosis? Let me explain now. When two solutions of different concentrations are separated by a semi-permeable membrane, the solvent molecule diffuse from dilute solution side to the concentrated solution side through the membrane, semical membrane, till the concentration becomes equal on either side of the membrane. Let me repeat again. When two solutions of different concentration are separated by a semi-permeable membrane, the solvent molecule diffuse from the dilute solution side to concentrated solution side through the membrane till the concentration becomes equal on either side of the membrane. This phenomenon is called osmosis. Kindly follow. This is called osmosis. Okay, so this osmosis you can visualize in this. So we have taken inverted funnel where the bottom is again, the semi-permeable membrane is introduced here, semi-permeable membrane. So you take a concentrated solution inside, outside it's a solvent. So if you fix, then automatically you will observe that after some time, the solvent from the outer will enter into the solution. This is going on taking place until the concentration same in both sides. This is called osmosis. Okay, right. So now we'll come for the Colgate effect. What is osmotic pressure? So the excess pressure which must be applied to solution to prevent the flow of the solvent into it through a semi-permeable membrane is known as osmotic pressure of the solution. This is the very interesting information. So I have already, what is osmosis? So solvent from a very dilute solution entered into the concentrated solution. If it is trying to enter, now we have to apply some pressure on the concentrated solution. That pressure will cause osmotic pressure. So we have to apply in such a way that, so it will prevent the flow of solvent into this through semi-permeable membrane. That is called osmotic pressure. Let me repeat again. The excess pressure which must be applied to solution to prevent the flow of solvent into it through semi-permeable membrane is known as osmotic pressure of the solution. That is pi. Okay. Now, there are two laws given under this osmotic pressure. They are identical to that of gas laws, Pi's law, Jass law. So, according to first law, the osmotic pressure of a solution at a constant temperature is directly proportional to concentration of the solution. Very, very interesting. First law. That is, pi is proportional to concentration. Here, C is nothing but molarity. Kindly have it in mind. In the case of elevation of boiling point, difference of freezing point, we have used the concentration of molality, small m. So, but here in osmotic pressure, we are using C, it is called molarity. Normally, molarity we are using capital M. So, in this case, we are using C, kindly follow. So, pi is proportional to C, where C is the molarity of the solution. This is the first law. The second law states that the osmotic pressure of a solution for a fixed concentration is directly proportional to absolute temperature T. That is, pi is proportional to T, this is second, at a fixed concentration, at a constant concentration. So we are getting two. Pi is proportional to T, pi is proportional to T. So by combining these two laws, I can get now pi e proportional to ct, mathematical form. Or I now to liquid this, I am introducing a constant R, where R is the proportionality constant or molar gas constant. So I am getting a very, very interesting equation. Pi equal to RCT. Pi, osmotic pressure. R, gas constant, molar gas constant. C, molarity. T, temperature. Okay. Now, from this, I can now go for determinate number. By using this osmotic pressure, measuring osmotic pressure, molecular weight of given unknown solid can be determined. So how to determine the molecular weight? Let me discuss now. By measuring osmotic pressure, the molecular weight can be calculated. What way? We know pi equal to RCT. What is molarity? Molarity is nothing but number of moles of solute present in 1 liter of solution. Mathematically, that can be given as C equal to N2 by V. Substitute N2 V, I am getting another equation, that is pi equal to N2 by RT divided by V. So, kindly follow, the pi osmotic pressure depends on N2, number of moles of solute. Since osmotic pressure depends on number of moles of solute, it is a colligative property. So, osmotic pressure is also a colligative property. Very, very interesting information. Now, so I am getting this equation pi equal to N2 RT by V. So now I will substitute N2. What is N2? I know. N2 number of moles of solute. Small M2 by capital M2. The mass of solute divided by molecular mass of solute. So that will give the equation. So I am getting this equation. So by rearranging, so M2 will go this side and pi will come this side. So I am getting the required equation as capital M2, that is molecular weight of solute, is equal to small m2 into RT divided by pi into V. What is M2? Small m2? Small m2 mass of solute, R molar gas constant, T temperature, pi osmotic pressure, and V volume of solution in liters. So by all these things, M2 can be calculated. Introducing all these terms, M2 can be calculated. The only remaining term is pi I have to measure in the laboratory. What way? Let me explain. Measurement of osmotic pressure. The osmotic pressure of a solution can be conveniently measured by Berkeley and Hartley method. By Berkeley and Hartley method, I can measure the osmotic pressure. So what we are now seeing is the instrument we are using. It consists of two tubes. One is inner tube, another is outer tube. That is, inner tube is made of semi-permeable membrane, outer tube is made of the gun metal. So inside we are taking a solvent, outside we are taking a solution. Kindly follow. So let me explain this. So the apparatus just now seen consists of two concentric tubes. The inner tube is made up of semi-permeable membrane and the two side tubes. The outer tube is made of gun metal which contains the solution. So outer tube containing solution, inner tube containing the liquid. This is the interesting information. Okay, now we are starting. A known weight of solvent, W1 gram, is taken in the inner tube inside the semi-permeable membrane, and a solution containing W2 gram of solute, the same kind of solvent, is taken in the outer tube, gunmetal. As a result of osmosis, so solvent from inner permeable membrane will enter into the solution, so the level will decrease. The level in the fourth side tube will decrease. So there is a fall of level in the capillary indicator. So the external pressure is now applied by means of a piston so that the level in the capillary indicator remains stationary. This pressure is measured, which is equal to osmotic pressure. Kindly follow. So let me explain with the diagram. Kindly follow. Now what will happen now? So this level in here in this solvent, the level will come down here in this again, the side tubes. So here it is already closed. So from the capillary tube, the level will come down. So we have to apply pressure here with the help of a piston so that the original level should be restored. So whatever pressure we are applying here, that is nothing but osmotic pressure. This is the interesting information. Okay, now. So the following are the advantages of this method. Number one, the osmotic pressure is recorded directly and the method is very quick. This is one advantage. The second one, there is no change in the concentration of solution during the measurement of osmotic pressure. This is number 2 advantage. Number 3, the osmotic pressure is balanced by the external pressure and there is minimum strain on the semipermeable membrane. So these are the 3 advantages we have during the measurement of this method. So what method we are using? It is called Berkeley and Hartley method we are using to measure the osmotic pressure. So far what we have discussed, what are the properties? Lowering of vapor pressure, elevation of boiling point, depression of freezing binder and osmotic pressure, all these are colligative properties. And these colligative properties depends on the number of particles, either molecules or ions or the solute. Abnormal results are observed in some cases where the solute undergo association or dissociation. The solute associates or dissociates in solution. This is a very, very interesting information. So, we have to discuss what is the abnormal colligative properties. Let me explain now. There are 2 ways we can discuss. One is association and another is dissociation. First, let me discuss abnormal colligative property as association of solid particles. Association of solid particle icon. Now, whenever there is association of solid particles, the number of effective molecules or particle decreases. So, for example, if any 2 particles undergo dimerization, so 2 particles will act as a single particle. So, the number of effective molecules decreases. And consequently, the colligative properties are lesser than the calculated on the basis of single molecule. So, whatever we measure, whenever there is association, the effective colligative properties will decrease. This is the most important information. Okay. So, just you get that acetic acid. So, this is the 1 molecule of acetic acid. This is another molecule of acetic acid undergo association. So what will happen now? This will now 2 molecule will act as a single particle, single molecule. 2 molecule act as a single molecule. Mean when you are calculating, so the number will decrease. Since the colligative properties are inversely proportional to molecular weight, inversely proportional to molecular weight. Because in all the cases, we will come across whether it is lady lowering of vapor pressure, elevation of boiling point, or depression of freezing point, or osmotic pressure. N2, directly proportional to N2, number of particles. What is N2? It is small M2 by capital M2, capital M2 coming in the below. So in the, it is M2, that is inversely proportional to molecular mass. So that is the most important. Since colligative properties are inversely proportional to molecular mass, the molecular weights of the solute in such cases will be higher than the true molecular mass. This is a very, very interesting example. For example, acetic acid just as in benzene will undergo dimerization. Chloroacetic acid in naphthalene will undergo dimerization. Okay. Now, in that case, so this is one. Second example, what is the dissociation of solid particle? Let me explain. Dissociation of solid particles. On the other hand, whenever there is dissociation, the number of effective particle increases, and hence the colligative properties are much higher than those calculated on the basis of undissociated single molecules. Kindly follow. So hence the molecular weights of solute in such cases will be lower than the true molecular weights. A specific example, sodium chloride. So sodium chloride, we are considering single particle, but it undergoes the ionization to give sodium plus and Cl minus. So it will act as 2 particles. On dissociation, sodium chloride will give 2 particles. So what we are measuring now, if you consider 1 particle, the value will be not be correct. So we are observing abnormal colligative properties. This is the interesting information. So in order to account this, whether it is undergoing association or dissociation, so a scientist called Van't Hoff so studied all this abnormal behavior and introduced a term called Van't Hoff factor. What is the Van't Hoff factor? So Van't Hoff, in order to account for all the abnormal cases, introduced a factor small i known as Van't Hoff factor, such that by introducing the I value we can have exact equations. Whether it is associated or dissociation, the equation will work out. Let me give it. What is I? I equal to experimental colligative properties divided by theoretical colligative property. So if you put the either it is the relative lowering of vapor pressure or relative boiling point or difference of breathing point or osmotic pressure, experimental value divided by theoretical value will give the I value. Since these properties vary inversely as the molecular weight of solid, I have already pointed out. Molecular weight of solute, that is N2, that is given by small m2 by capital M2, inversely proportional. So I will take the other form, that is theoretical molecular weight divided by experimental molecular weight. So if the colligative properties are given, I can be calculated. Or molecular weight will be given, again we can calculate I value in both cases. This is the interesting information, right? Now, another interesting information here is the degree of dissociation or association can be calculated. So the degree of dissociation alpha is given as, whenever there is a dissociation, that is alpha will be given as I minus 1 by N minus 1. That is I minus 1 by N minus 1. What is I? I is Van der Waals factor and N number of ions or particles, number of particles. This is the interesting information. So, if you know I value, if you know the colligative properties, you can calculate I. And if you know molecular weight, you can calculate I. And from the nature of the particle, we can calculate N. So, alpha, degree of dissociation can be calculated. The degree of association of again alpha is also can be calculated using this equation. That is, 1 minus I into N divided by N minus 1. As usual, I equal to Van der Waals factor and N equal to number of particles we can calculate. This is a very, very interesting information. Okay. Now, so after getting the I values, by inclusion of Van der Waals factor, we can get the modification of the equation. So, we will give you a correct colligative properties. It is as follows. That is, so inclusion of Van der Waals factor modifies the equations for colligative properties as follows. So relative lowering of vapor pressure. The original P0, relative lowering of vapor pressure P0 minus P by P0, relative lowering of vapor pressure. Original form, we know N2 by N1. Now, we can by introducing I factor, so I into N2 by N1 will give the correct value. This is the very, very interesting information. The same way, elevation of boiling point. The original form delta TB equal to KB into M. But now, by introducing I value, then we'll get the modified version. The delta TB equal to I into KB into M. This is for the elevation of boiling point we can calculate. So, accurate value, whether it is undergoing association or dissociation, we can get the correct value. The same way, under the depression of freezing point. That is depression of freezing point also now we can. But we, that is, we know original equation is delta Tf is equal to Kf into M is the original equation. So by introducing I value here, so I into Kf into M, so we can get now the correct value for depression of freezing point. Okay. The last one is osmotic pressure. So osmotic pressure again, that is pi equal to N2R2 by V, N2R2 by V. But now that's the original. By introducing I value, you will get the correct equation again. Pi equal to I, N2R2 by V is the correct equation for. So by introducing I term, there is undergoing association or dissociation. So by introducing the I value suitably in these equations, we can calculate accurately the corresponding the colligative properties. So this is the very, very interesting information taken. So let me conclude now. So what is the colligative property? The colligative property is a property which depends on number of particles. There are four types of colligative property: relative lowering of vapor pressure, lowering of vapor pressure, relative lowering of vapor pressure, elevation of boiling point, difference of freezing point, and osmotic pressure. So in all the cases, I have discussed how we have to derive the equation for determination of molecular weight. And for the determination, we have to determine the corresponding colligative property using a specific method. So by introducing these values, colligative property value into the suitable equation, we can be able to determine the molecular weight. And finally, what I have discussed, the abnormal colligative property. Whenever there is association, Whenever there is dissociation, we are not getting the correct values. So, Van't Hoff introduced a factor called the I factor. By introducing I value in this suitable equation, we can get the correct result for the Kolmogorov properties. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture.